All right. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to introduce our next speaker for our seminar series. This is Dr. Amanda Garner, who is Assistant Professor of Medicinal Chemistry at the College of Pharmacy at the University of Michigan. Dr. Garner received her Ph.D. at the University of Pittsburgh and postdoced at Scripps in La Jolla, California, where it was very dry there for a while.
The whole time I was there, they were in drought.
They were in drought. Apparently now they're drowning. Right.
Yeah, now they're drowning.
Now they're drowning. But at any rate, her current work is interesting, and it deals at the intersection of chemical biology, medicinal chemistry, molecular and cellular biology, as it studies messenger RNA and protein synthesis. We'd like to welcome Dr. Garner for being here, for journeying from the University of Michigan, and we look forward to your speech, talk.
Yeah, thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you for the kind introduction, and thank you for the invitation to come out here and tell you about some of the amazing research going on at the University of Michigan. Hopefully it will convince you to think about research in your future career and research at the University of Michigan. So my talk today, the research in my lab is focused on using chemical approaches for targeting translational control. And I'll talk about what that means, but before I talk about my research, because you know this is an undergraduate audience, I kind of wanted to give some background on how I got to where I am today. So like you all, I went to a very small college called Allegheny College doing liberal arts education, so I was a chemistry major. And one summer in between my junior and senior year, I was very fortunate to do research outside of my university at the University of Pittsburgh. And actually this project here, so doing some solid phase organic synthesis, a reaction called cross metathesis. I worked on this project as an RAU student. So we were trying to revolutionize library synthesis and how people made drug-like molecules. And I was really passionate about this type of research. It was very hot topic in the early 2000s. I know that's way before your time. But this is really exciting, and I was really excited to get to do that kind of research as an undergrad and then bring back what I learned over the summer at this big research institution, University of Pittsburgh, to my home college. And I was so excited about what I did in the summer that I went back and I joined my RAU mentor's lab as a PhD graduate student. And we got to publish this nice paper in Orglet on my method that I started as an RAU student and then got to continue as a graduate student. In the end, it wasn't as amazing as we hoped. It didn't really work out like we hoped. I spent 3 hard years doing that work. But it was a really good training opportunity, and I learned a lot about different organic reactions, solid phase synthesis, and a number of other areas. And another project I work on was in fluorescent probes. So we were trying to design, this is a molecule called fluorescein, dichlorofluorescein, shown here. It's what's in like Mountain Dew. A lot of they dye the river in Chicago at St. Patrick's Day with fluorescein to make it green. So this is a very common fluorescent molecule, and we were trying to make fluorescein derivatives that were more cell permeable, because this doesn't really cross the cell membrane that easily. And out of that, and doing organic chemistry to make these molecules, we serendipitously discovered new fluorescent probes for palladium, platinum, and then we applied the same type of methodology to ozone. So my background is really organic chemistry and applying it to different types of things. So whether it's the synthesis of drug-like molecules, fluorescent molecules, assay development, using this kind of merge between organic and analytical chemistry, which then when I went to do my postdoc, I took that with me. So I was always interested in doing some kind of biology-related research, always wanted to do it. I started out, like many of you, wanted to do pre-med, took organic chemistry, was mesmerized and fascinated by organic chemistry. I was like, nope, that's what I'm going to do. I'm done with medicine. I don't like blood. I don't like being in the hospital. I can't do it. I like the lab. This is the place for me. So that interest in biology always continued. So my undergraduate mentors were like, yeah, that's fine. Biology is interesting, but chemistry is where it's at. All of biology is chemistry, and you need to have that fundamental education in chemistry and be able to apply that to biology. So when I finally had my PhD in chemistry, I'm like, now I have all the chemistry knowledge I need. I can go and tackle some biological problems. And so the first project I work on was some assay development, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. So we developed a methodology using copper catalyzed click chemistry to basically enable a biochemical, a new type of biochemical assay. And then I did a number of projects in different areas of chemical probes or small molecules to interrogate biology for a number of different projects. So some dendrimer work here in bacterial quorum sensing. I worked in some chitinase research for anti-oncocerciasis agents, more bacterial work, some anti-cancer agents, and a number of other projects that are not even on this slide. So armed with this now knowledge of chemistry and biology, when I wanted to set up my lab, I was like, we're going to do all of this. We're going to do everything. We're going to do chemistry and biology in one lab. And we all, in my lab, we have one fundamental question is that it is really interrogating what I call the chemical biology of mRNA translation or protein synthesis. And to tackle this central question, we take a number of different approaches. So we have small molecule and peptide library synthesis going back to my organic chemistry roots, assay and design and development from what I did as a graduate student and postdoc in these kind of assay development projects. Fluorescent imaging probes, I can't let that part of me go. I really feel strongly that fluorescence is really cool. It's really gives you nice pictures, but enables a lot of different types of experiments that you can do. Preach, yes. See, they sent me here to tell you guys what you need to do. And then in the end, you know, once we have all of our chemical tools and methods, we can apply them to understand more about molecular and cell biology, and then ultimately target validation for new drug discovery projects. So in terms of protein synthesis or mRNA translation, we really try to tackle this from the 5' to the 3' end of the mRNA. So at the 5' end, we're investigating protein-protein interactions involved in cap-dependent translation initiation, which I'll talk a little bit more in the second part of my talk. And then we also look at microRNA-mediated gene silencing at the 3' end, and I'll give you background on both of those areas of biology. But what you may wonder is, how did someone who did palladium, fluorescent probes, these chemical probes for many different things, come up with this as their independent research project? Well, it actually all went back to when I was about third to fourth year graduate student. I read a paper in the journal called Cell on small molecule inhibition of the interaction between the translation initiation factors EIF4E and EIF4G. So in this paper, it was the first small molecule probe molecule looking at targeting cap-dependent translation as a drug target. And I was like, wow, this is really cool. You know, at the time, a lot of people were looking at transcription factors and targeting that level of gene expression, but no one was really looking at the penultimate step of making protein. It was like, this is where chemists should go. No chemists are really working on this, and in fact, the lead author of this is actually a structural biologist, so a little bit random, but he had studied this protein structurally for a long time, and they did some very simple studies in this, but very, very groundbreaking as a new area of cancer drug discovery. And then later that same year, these small microRNAs, so these are about 20 nucleotide RNAs, were found to also inhibit this same translation initiation process by targeting this cap complex. So this is cap binding EIF4F is part of these two proteins. So like, that's really cool. So we have two areas. We have protein-protein interactions, we have these RNAs. And microRNAs, later that year, were really touted to be the next big thing in science. So this was from Science Magazine in 2008. Basically, researchers will start using microRNAs to unveil disease mechanisms and will solve fundamental puzzles. So these were really cool areas. They were really up and coming, and I was really inspired by these works and these ideas. So from 2007 to 2013, when I started my lab, I'd been reading every paper, really thinking this is where, you know, I'm going to make my impact. So today I'm going to tell you about three of the stories from things that we've been doing to target this chemical biology of mRNA translation problem. So I'll start with assay design and development. And although, you know, we tackle the mRNA from 5' to 3', we're going to go in reverse. We're going to go from 3' to 5', starting with the microRNAs and our work in targeting RNA drug discovery. And then I'm going to switch gears and talk about our work in cap-dependent translation at the 5' end. We'll talk about our work in 4-ABP staple peptides, also some assay development for discovering small molecule modulators of this process. And then finally, I'm going to finish up with a little bit of proteomics. So we do some proteomics as well, so we're not just synthesis and assays. So a different type of assay for uncovering new kinases that can affect this cap-dependent translation process. Okay. So to give some background on what types of assays people use to screen for drugs. So primarily these are things that we refer to as single turnover fluorescence methods. So things like fluorescence polarization, which is, so if you have a fluorescently labeled biomolecule and then you're looking at an interaction with another biomolecule, so you can have low polarization, meaning so plain polarized light, it tries to excite this fluorophore. So if it's free, now you'll have low polarization of that light because it's floppy, it's moving around everywhere, it's rotating. Whereas, you know, now if you have it bound, you'll have high FP because it's stationary and the plain polarized light hits it and you get high fluorescence polarization. So that's one example of an assay. The second is something called FRET, or fluorescence resonance energy transfer, which is basically due to distance. So if we look here, so if you have some donor fluorophore attached to one biomolecule and an acceptor fluorophore attached to another biomolecule and they interact, as long as this distance is within about 10 angstrom, you'll see a FRET signal. Okay, so these are one event, one binding event yields one signal. Okay, and these are very widely used, although they have many disadvantages. Okay, so when you think about screening for drug molecules, these assays are highly subject to something known as compound interference, and that means so you get a number of false positives and negatives. So now if we have this fluorescent molecule, some of your drug-like molecules might be also fluorescent. So that means, you know, if that overlapping fluorescence would interfere with your assay, giving you a false result. Similarly, fluorescent molecules can be quenched by a number of different, say, metal ions or other molecules, especially those that have high electron donating character, and then you'll also get a false result. So, you know, you want to really, in terms of drug discovery, you want to be able to have access to what we call chemical space, all chemical space. You know, all possible molecules could be drugs for your target. So having this compound interference really limits these assays. Another limitation is limited sensitivity, and this stems from the fact that they are single turnover. One binding event yields one signal. And from my work in my palladium probe, which is a catalytic signal amplification, I knew that this was a limitation going forward. So with these limitations and these methodologies, we really hypothesize that we have using these types of methods have the possibility of many missed opportunities for small molecule discovery. So we wanted to come up with, or I guess I wanted to come up with, because my group wasn't with me at the time, a new method for tackling this kind of drug screening problem. So based on my PhD and my postdoc work, I knew that assays armed with catalytic signal amplification are really superior for ultra-sensitive detection. So one binding event yields many signals, so you can get much higher sensitivity. And really the inspiration of this in terms of a biochemical sense is our enzyme immunoassays, so ELISA, and something known as catalytic ELISA, or cat ELISA, which is depicted here. So back in the days, so we thought that we could generate things called catalytic antibodies, so antibodies that act like enzymes. That didn't really come to fruition, but this method did, so that was good for us. So you have something that is immobilized to a surface, so this would be a small molecule that could undergo some kind of catalytic antibody or enzymatic reaction, would be converted into a product, so now we'd get this little blue guy here, and then this product, you would generate an antibody specific for that product for its recognition, and then just like in a normal ELISA, this antibody would be recognized by an enzyme-linked secondary antibody, and then the signal would be amplified dependent upon the concentration of product and HRP antibody bound. Okay, so when I was a grad or a postdoc, I had a problem with an acyl transferase. And at the time, the only methods for detecting acyl transferase activities were radioassays, so using radio-labeled substrates. And my postdoc mentor said, we want to do this, figure out how to make it work, no radioassays, it has to be fluorescent. So I was at Scripps, and there's a well-known type of chemistry that was invented at Scripps called click chemistry. So I was like, maybe we can do this. Okay, so I basically, from that, you know, being posed with that challenge and being in the environment that I was at, came up with a conceptually new assay system called catalytic enzyme link click chemistry assay, okay, or CAT-ELCA as we call it in my lab. So in this case, we now still have an immobilized, so in this case, DNA, RNA, protein, so an immobilized biomolecule. But in this case, instead of just having an immobilized biomolecule or a small molecule, whatever peptide you want, we add a click label to it, okay? And this click label can then be detected by, instead of an antibody-mediated reaction, undergoing a click reaction with a horseradish peroxidase labeled with the other partner of the click reaction. And I'll go through the examples of what that means. So then in the end, what you get is this immobilized HRP-conjugated biomolecule that now you can detect similar to that with antibody-linked secondary enzymes, okay? So we're really hoping that this new approach, CAT-ELCA, can catalyze drug discovery through click chemistry. And to give you some background on what click chemistry is, click chemistry was put forth by the Nobel laureate Barry Sharpless, who's at Scripps. So in 2001, he published a very nice review in Engavante Chimie about these spring-loaded reactions. So they're basically spring-loaded to react. So A and B will just click together to yield product. So high thermodynamic driving force and reaction rate. There's a number of different kind of criteria that makes a reaction a click reaction. So modular, wide in scope, high yield, no byproducts, stereospecific, simple reaction conditions, readily available starting materials, and no solvent or solvent that is benign. Okay, so simple product isolation, et cetera. So basically these things are just supposed to work, you know, in an ideal system, the product crashes out and then boom, you're done, click, right? Click for organic chemistry. Okay, so everyone was really excited about this idea, and there's a number of different reactions that one can apply here, but where this type of click reaction really took off, or click chemistry, is in bio-orthogonal chemistry, or bioconjugation. And there's a number of different types of what we call click reactions now for labeling biomolecules, DNA, RNA, and protein. So my lab primarily uses the copper-catalyzed click chemistry shown here, and then this inverse electron demand Diels-Alder chemistry down here, and we'll talk a little bit more about that reaction, okay? So really this type of, you know, taking a very basic concept in chemistry has really revolutionized how we do biology and biochemistry. Okay, so getting back to CAT-ELCA, and just to summarize some of the advantages that we think of our approach. So unlike the fluorescence polarization and FRET assays I showed, we have access to all chemical spaces ligands because we have a washing step that basically remove any fluorescent molecule, fluorescent quencher that would interfere with your assay readout. So in theory, any molecule is fair game for our assay approach. Relatedly, it's not subject to compound interference because we wash out these molecules. It's highly sensitive due to the fact that now we have this catalytic signal amplification, which is mediated by conjugation to horseradish peroxidase, or HRP. The cool thing is all the reagents are commercially or readily obtained, making it user-friendly. And in fact, we should talk more because my lab has always been thinking about how we could make this into a kit for undergraduate education because all the reagents are pretty easily accessible. You have access to multi-mode detection, so while chemiluminescence as a readout is the most sensitive, you can easily do this with fluorescence or absorbance, so any type of plate reader, cuvette, et cetera, you can use with CAT-ELCA. Finally, there's no need for antibodies. So in normal ELISA, so we think of ELISA as detecting drugs or many other types of biomolecules in the hospital, and they all use antibodies generated for those products. But we just use click chemistry and a simple HRP. So this makes it really cheap and widely applicable to any system, in particular RNA. So our interest in RNA-targeted drug discovery, you really can't generate an antibody for RNA, so ELISA is not really an option for those types of RNA assays. Okay. So with this idea, my lab, as I said, tackles two different types of biology. One is microRNAs, and specifically we look at pre-microRNA maturation. We have a CAT-ELCA for that I'll go through in a few moments. And then the second CAT-ELCA that we have developed is for protein-protein interactions, which, you know, we are looking at a system for cap-dependent translation, but could be applied to nearly any protein-protein interaction that you can think about. Okay, so we'll start with the microRNA work. Okay, so as some background, microRNAs are a class of 21 to 23 nucleotide non-coding RNAs. The exact mechanism of these is not known, but they do function in translational repression, either through inhibition of translation or causing degradation of the mRNA. There's about 1,000 predicted human microRNAs believed to control the activity of greater than 60% of all protein-coding genes. So there's massive regulation of gene expression through these small little RNAs. And relatedly, they found to play crucial roles in nearly all aspects of human biology, from development to disease. Now, a microRNA is transcribed primarily from its own gene. So these are endogenous RNA substrates. So it goes through transcription by RNA polymerase 2 to yield an intermediate known as a pri-microRNA, which is about 1,000 plus nucleotides. It undergoes two processing steps to get down to the mature 21 nucleotide RNA. So the first is carried out by an enzyme known as drosha, which is also an RNase. Gets exported from the nucleus to the cytoplasm as a pre-microRNA, which is something that will be important for our research. The cytosolic pre-microRNA of 60 to 80 nucleotides undergoes a second maturation process by another RNase known as dicer to yield the mature microRNA duplex, which then only one strand of that microRNA duplex eventually goes on to silence gene expression. Okay, but we'll recap some of those steps as necessary for our assay design. Okay, so with respect to a role in disease, I said that microRNA expression is implicated in nearly all human diseases and development, and these are just some of the most commonly studied microRNAs, or ones that have been really kind of validated for their role in disease. As you can see, a huge role in cancer, viral infection, diabetes. So microRNAs are interesting with respect to cancer, as some of them are typically overexpressed, and we call those oncomeres, whereas others are lost in cancer, and they have a tumor suppressor function. So they kind of, you know, different microRNAs do different things. And in my lab, we have come up with assays to target both types of microRNAs, heart failure and other cardiovascular diseases as well. So the two in asterisks, actually, there are targeted therapies in clinical trials. And with respect to targeting an RNA, really the go-to type of methodology is something known as antisense oligonucleotides, or ASOs. So what these are other small RNAs, so they're highly chemically modified for stability, affinity, et cetera. And they function, in this case for the anti-mer, by binding to that microRNA and with high sequence complementarity and sequestering its activity. So these are both in preclinical and clinical trials. MicroRNA mimetics are another type of oligonucleotide-based drug for targeting microRNAs. And as I said, for the ones in cancer that act as tumor suppressors, these are lost. So basically, they are just mimics of that lost microRNA for microRNA replacement therapies. And this is also in preclinical and clinical trials. But for both of these strategies, and using these type of oligonucleotide-based drugs, there are many liabilities that have yet to be solved, and this is a very long-standing problem. So off-target effects, right, you're just based on, you know, the four base sequence, so it's very hard to get high specificity for your target. Drug delivery is a huge problem, and I know you guys have experience with dendrimers and maybe know about how things like dendrimers can deliver oligonucleotide drugs. But the problem is it goes everywhere, and you might want some target or tissue specificity, so this is a big problem. Toxicity, there's some toxicities across the board with this, and then they're very expensive, both in the RNA synthesis and in the delivery. Okay, so my lab wants to do small molecules for kind of tackling this problem. But with RNA, there's a lot of challenges, and this has been really a long-standing problem. Okay, so if we think about RNA in comparison to a protein, what would we see? Okay, basically it's completely negative. Huge negative electrostatic potential. Whereas proteins, they have a nice, you know, mix of everything. We got some neutral, positive, negative. So it's really easy when you have all these different types of electrostatic interactions going on to make molecules for binding that. Whereas with RNA, it's negative, so what do you want to do? Throw something positive at it. But how can you get specificity if you just go based on that electrostatic potential? So that's something that's challenging about working with RNA. The second is something that you may not even think about. RNA, unlike DNA, which is a double-stranded helix, right? RNA is actually single-stranded and folds onto itself into many different conformations and secondary structures. So there's a lot of structural plasticity, meaning it's highly dynamic because it is actually single-stranded. So how do you find a molecule to capture one conformation, and which conformation is it? That's a challenge. The third is RNA abundance. So about 90% plus of your RNA is just ribosomal or transfer tRNA, okay? So here's the ribosome, bacterial ribosome. There you go. Most of your RNA is in this. So how do you find that one little microRNA you want in this vast sea of ribosomal and transfer RNA? So these are some of the challenges. But a positive, what's an upside about RNA? It's not your average V-form double helix. RNA can adopt a wide variety of secondary structures. So you can have a hairpin loop, so it's not very perfectly base paired like you would think for DNA. This is HIV tar RNA, which is involved in HIV disease. You have your transfer tRNAs, which form this beautiful cloverleaf structure. And then look at the ribosome. So there's three RNAs. They're from small to huge. tRNA in the middle of its nice cloverleaf structure. But there's all kind of structure in there. So this is something that has in common with protein. So while it may be hugely negatively charged, it can form an amazing number of secondary and tertiary structures. So if it can form structure, we should be able to target it with some molecule. Okay. So how do we do this? Well, there's something called chemical space. So in terms of, you know, the number of drug-like molecules that exist in all of chemical space, if we take all the carbons, hydrogens, oxygens, nitrogens, it's about greater than 10 to the 60th molecules would be possible. Can you make all of those? No, because not enough atoms exist in the universe to do this. But, you know, the number of molecules is vast. But for targeting RNA, because of those challenges, we know very few scaffolds that can actually do it. So we have things like aminoglycoside antibiotics, represented here by neomycin, which is the active ingredient in Neosporin. Okay? So these are antibiotics. And how do antibiotics work? A lot of these types of antibiotics, they target the bacterial ribosome, which is composed of RNA. So we know a lot from those kind of natural product studies. We know the tetracyclines also bind to ribosomal RNA, mediated by this positively charged amine. And then another class of molecule that we know about are these things called the Hoche dyes. And these are essentially nonspecific nucleic acid stains. So you add, you know, a molecule like DAPI to your cell, immediately goes to the nucleus, turns blue to detect the DNA in your nucleus. So this is what you're looking at. Three types of molecules for binding RNA. This is not good. This is not good enough for us because you're never going to get specificity or be able to probe an individual RNA using these scaffolds. So, you know, our goal is really looking at microRNAs, but our big picture goal is to, you know, use our assay approach to discover new chemical space for targeting RNA and basically prove, is it druggable, right? Because with these molecules, we can say no. We can say the ribosome is druggable, but probably no other RNA is druggable. How do we find new molecules for targeting this? Okay. So if we whittle it down to one biological hypothesis, because you have to have a hypothesis when you design your experiment. So in terms of going back to our microRNA maturation theory, so we know that mature microRNAs, so these guys, are the ones that are actually responsible for the business end of the microRNA. So what we hypothesize is if we could find molecules that could bind to this pre-microRNA and essentially inhibit the maturation process, that this would be a way to potently inhibit microRNA-mediated gene regulation, so prohibit the generation of this mature microRNA. And this reaction is carried out by the enzyme Dicer, which is shown here. So this is the Giardia Dicer. So human Dicer has not yet been crystallized. But in the orange, you can see this is the pre-microRNA hairpin loop represented kind of schematically here. So it makes a number of contacts all the way down with the base paired double-stranded region, and then also with the loop region as well. So there's a number of different, you know, secondary structures within even the hairpin loop pre-microRNA for binding to small molecules. So that's where we set it up. Okay. So if we look at the CAD-ALCA for this, so I'll kind of walk you through how we designed this. So again, we have our immobilized biomolecule, and the type of immobilization we use. So we take a streptavidin-coated surface, we take our biotinylated biomolecule, so the affinity for biotin for streptavidin is basically almost covalent, so that's a very, very strong way to immobilize a molecule. So we can buy these pre-microRNAs chemically synthesized. We buy them, and they come with all the labels we want, except for our click handle, which we add chemically. Okay, so in terms of the click handle on our RNA, it's usually either an alkyne for the copper catalyzed click chemistry, or this transcyclooctene for doing something called inverse electron demand Diels-Alder chemistry. So if we have Dicer, so this is the RNase that matures the microRNA, it will cleave off the terminal loop, just like Dicer does. And then if we add our horseradish peroxidase click chemistry reagent, so in this case it would be HRP linked with an azide or a methyl tetrazine, we would see no signal because there's no click handle to react on. Now, if we oppose that and we have some kind of inhibitor, whether it binds to the microRNA, which is what we're hoping, or we could find general Dicer inhibitors, we would now block this step, and that tag would be intact. So now if we do our click chemistry detection, this horseradish peroxidase will now be covalently linked to our pre-microRNA, enabling our catalytic signal amplification. Okay. So in terms of doing this, so you know these obviously both work. They have papers attached to them, so that's good. I think I skipped the slide. Yeah. Okay, so in terms of characterization, when one is going to design an assay, there are a number of experiments that you have to show that your assay actually works and works the way that you want it to. Okay, so we have dependent on Dicer, so we can increase the number of units and we see more cleavage, so less signal, okay? So because less tag is left on the RNA. We can just change how much RNA we immobilize. So if we have less RNA immobilized, we should get less signal because now we don't have any handle again. So one thing I forgot to mention about Dicer, it is a magnesium-dependent, so metal-dependent enzyme. So if you chelate that metal, again, you don't have any activity, so you get high signal. And then, you know, in terms of the chemical space for RNA, we needed to prove that you could inhibit this and do something with it. So we used the well-known nuclear stain, kind of based on that last scaffold I showed you in the chemical space slide, DAPI. And we can inhibit this through non-specific electrostatic interaction of DAPI with the RNA. But because our goal is finding new chemical space, we really needed to adapt this to be done by robots, right? People don't do drug screening, robots do drug screening. And one key experiment that you have to do to translate your assay for high-throughput screening is to make sure that it can be done in what's called automated liquid handling, or having robots, you know, dispense all your stuff and do all of your experiments for you. You press a button and transfer it out. So my student, Dan Lorenz, he has single-handedly done all this work, including all of the automated high-throughput screening. So this is an experiment where he essentially set up a bunch of negative reactions, some positive reactions where Dicer is not there, and you get what is known as a Z-prime score, Z-prime factor. So it takes into consideration standard deviation, average, et cetera. This is the formula. We don't need to belabor the point. But what you do need to know is that assays that have Z-prime factors of 1 to 0.5 are deemed as excellent, and you know, go ahead, do your screen, it's good enough. Okay. So what we showed is that it is amenable to robotic liquid handling, has good statistics, or a signal to background of 11.5 and Z-prime factor of 0.74. And it took a lot of time to get that way, because actually with the copper reaction, we could not get good statistics. So we actually had to go to the much faster Diels-Alder reaction to actually make this happen. Okay, but once we did, we were excited, we can go do high throughput screening. So we have the University of Michigan, our Center for Chemical Genomics, where we have all these fancy toys that will make and essentially do your experiments for you, which is what we all strive for. Whether it's graduate students or robots, you know, everyone doing your experiments for you. So we have all these kind of fancy toys, and it's really cool because when I was doing some screening for my assay that I developed as a postdoc, I had to do it all by hand pipetting every well. Could only do 96 well plate, and now my student, you know, he has access to all these resources, and Scripps is a very good institution. We just didn't have them at our campus. He gets to just press a button and have it go. It can do 384 well experiments very fast. Okay. So we did this, and what do? So we screened a lot of compounds, and you get a lot of pieces of data. So we screened about 50,000 what we'll call small molecules, and there's a professor at the University of Michigan who is big in natural products. So he has a collection of about 35,000 natural product extracts, and we screened all of these, so you can see a lot of data you have to go through. Okay, where compounds, you know, so here is our negatives, right? So these would not be inhibitors. These are our positives, just as positive control, and all these green dots are samples. So this also includes follow-up studies on hit molecules, but you know, things that up here and things that are middle are all things that could be possible, you know, hits. Okay, so if we think about the statistics of this, okay, and this is probably the most depressing part of high throughput screening. Okay, we'll take this side, small molecules. Okay, so we screened 47,130 small molecules. Out of that, and we had a very marginal definition for what we call the hit, because, you know, we're working on the cusp, but we want to find new chemical space, and we know that most, you know, for targeting RNA, the likelihood you're going to find something, you know, we have to go really low, because another kind of goal is this, is finding selectivity, selective molecules. So we made our cutoff very generous. So out of those 47,000, we have about 1,500 initial hits, so 3.1% of the entire library we retested, okay? And how we retest that is we just screen it three more times. Same concentrations, just do a triplicate assay. And of those 1,480, only 170 of them confirm. So now we're down to 0.36%, and that's by this definition of greater than three standard deviations. So now what we did is we ran these 170 confirmed hit in dose response curve. So we did from 0 to 120 micromolar. Now we're down to 0.06% of the library. And then we ran a selectivity screen because we were looking at, so this is an oncogenic microRNA. We ran it against another microRNA substrate. And from that 30, only 7 had some level of selectivity. So 0.01% of the whole library we took. So that's a lot of experiments. Same thing for the natural products. So you can see we get down to 0.07%. And these ones have varying, so this is kind of cheating. Because about the 22 that we're going to do regrowth and re-extract, so these are microbial natural products, they have varying selectivity. And some are, you know, potent and not selective. Some are, like, not potent at all, but they have some selectivity. Because we're trying to find new chemical space, and a great place to find that is natural products. Because if we think about those antibiotics, they were natural products. So this is probably very generous. It might actually be 0.001%. I don't know. Very low. Okay, so kind of depressing. And I wish I had more to tell you, but we have a lot of work to still do. Okay, so we have our 7 molecules, and we're doing tons and tons and tons of experiments on them to figure out, do they work, do they not work, how do, you know, are they selective, are they not selective? And there's a number of other assays that you have to do. So once you have a high throughput screen, it's just one assay. But that one assay doesn't really tell you much because it could be due to formatting. It could be due to many other. We have an immobilized RNA. It could be due to many things. So you have to basically panel these molecules across a number of different experiments to actually show that they are working. But in the meantime, because my student who's working on this was so confident that he would be able to, you know, get to the end and find this molecule, he started another RNA project looking at, so these are for the tumor suppressor microRNAs. Looking at RNA binding protein interactions. So for many of the tumor suppressor microRNAs, their maturation is actually inhibited by protein binding. So he is thinking that we could find molecules that would block this RNA protein interaction, and those would be new chemical probes for interrogating microRNA biology. So he is actually an amazing student. He came up with this idea, we wrote a grant, and we got $300,000 for this project. So this is his independent idea. So a lot of people probably wouldn't have let him do that, but I thought it was pretty good, and he's really great. So University of Michigan has great graduate students. Okay, so now we're just gonna switch gears completely. So a lot of work still to be done. So we need team members for the RNA project, so think about that. Okay, so now we'll just talk about protein-protein interactions. So if you think about your proteome, all the proteins in your proteome, about 40,000 to 200,000 make interactions with another protein. So that's the number of protein-protein interactions within your interactome. And from a drug discovery standpoint, they have been called undruggable, not because they're negatively charged, but because they're basically flat hydrophobic surfaces. There's not beautiful pockets like you think for enzymes that have natural ligands. So this has made it very, very challenging. And they make a number of different types of interfaces. So you can have domain-domain, this kind of induced fit where these two circles then, you know, make additional structures upon only after binding. Some use only a peptide of one protein and bind to a whole protein, whether it's through this kind of like goofy structure or maybe a helix. And then you can have coils or leucine zippers like in MicMac. So there's many different ways the two proteins can come together. So thinking about this again from an assay design standpoint, the same assays apply. So fluorescence polarization, FRET are the go-tos for protein-protein interactions. But now we add another disadvantage, and that is these types of assays can't really look at all protein-protein interactions. So they're very good at motif domain and domain-domain interactions, but things that induce a lot of structure are multi, you know, domain subunit protein-protein interactions. You can't use these type of methodologies for that. So then what do? We go to CATALCA because it's awesome. And CATALCA can do it. We can do full-length proteins. It doesn't matter how big. It could be 200 kilodalton, and we can do this. So again, same kind of setup. We have our streptavidin plate, biotinylated protein, immobilize it, flow in our other protein with our click handle. So in the presence of an inhibitor, no interaction would happen, no signal. In the presence of that protein alone, we would retain our click signal, our click handle, do our click chemistry, and boom, there we go. We get our signal generation. And now getting into cap-dependent translation, how does this come in? Okay, so here's the background on cap-dependent translation. And this is where we applied our PPI CATALCA. So it's the most energetically expensive process of cell of gene expression. So about 40% of the total energy and oxygen requirements of your cell simply go into making protein. So it's four main steps, so initiation, elongation, termination, and recycling. But it is well known and well established that initiation is the rate determining step of all protein synthesis. And it's carried out about 20 translation initiation factors, the tRNA initiator complex and initiator tRNA. But of all of those translation initiation factors, there's one that is the most important, and that's a protein known as EIF4E, or eukaryotic translation initiation factor 4E. And what its job is to find the 5' prime of the mRNA, all of which has this 7-methylguanosine cap. Okay, so it makes a very specific interaction with this methylated nucleotide to basically select the mRNA to be translated from the entire pool. Okay, so it selects which one it wants to bind. And because it has such an important job, it's highly regulated, principally by a class of three EIF4E binding proteins known as the 4EBPs, so isoforms 1, 2, and 3. And these are small proteins, about 10 to 12 kilodaltons. They compete with another translation initiation factor known as EIF4G, so that first paper why I became interested in this research, and they bind the same site. So 4EBP1 and EIF4G combine for this site, this dorsal site on EIF4E. So when 4EBP1 is bound, cap-dependent translation is inhibited. When EIF4G is bound, cap-dependent translation is stimulated. And this activity of 4EBP1 has to be, you know, turned on and off. And how that happens is phosphorylation. So when it's hypophosphorylated, meaning no phosphos, it binds tightly to sequester EIF4E. But then upon stimulation of growth pathways, 4EBP1 will become hyperphosphorylated and release EIF4E for binding and joining the translation initiation complex. So why this is important in disease, in particular cancer, is that EIF4E really sits at a nexus for oncogenic signaling. So these are very common pathways, PI3K pathway, RAS pathway, and both of them feed into this CAP-dependent translation process. Okay, so in terms of the PI3K pathway, which is the principal pathway that my lab studies, it's 4-ABP phosphorylation is carried out by a kinase known as mammalian target of rapamycin, or mTOR, which forms this much larger complex known as mTOR complex 1 or mTORC1. And this is activated through this important PI3K pathway. Okay, so again, active 4-ABP1, inactive EIF4E, and then inactive 4-ABP1, active EIF4E. Okay, so this is really mTOR, RAS, of course, PI3K, these are huge drug targets in cancer. And basically, one of our hypotheses is, you know, it's great. So RAS is something that has been undruggable for a long time. Maybe we'll never get there. Kinases, you know, you have a lot of drug resistance with kinases. They're not necessarily, they'll work for a while and then they won't work anymore. Why not just target this ultimate downstream process of CAP-dependent translation as opposed to targeting these upstream signals? Okay. So let's look a little bit at the interaction. Okay, so 4-ABP1 is an interesting protein in that it's intrinsically disordered. So when it's not bound to EIF4E, it has no structure at all, it's just free flopping everywhere. But when it binds to EIF4E, it undergoes a disorder to order transition. And you can see here, it forms a short little alpha helix, and that's a key interaction. There is a second binding site here, but it's not really well-defined structure. And so we have looked at this as opposed to the EIF4G binding interaction with EIF4E because we're hoping to take advantage of these additional contacts beyond the canonical helix motif. So in terms of our PPI CADALCA for this protein-protein interaction, so I went through the schematic of it, and here are some unpublished results, so we're just getting ready to hit submit on the paper. But here you can see the assay works. So it's very sensitive, so with EIF4E, and our click-labeled 4-ABP1, we see a strong signal to background greater than 120. And then if we leave out any of the other things, we essentially see no signal. So it works amazingly. And then for some characterization, so we can do dependence on EIF4E immobilized, and we see a nice dependence. This is measuring the interaction with differing concentrations of our 4-ABP1. So we see, based on CADALCA, KD, of depending on the protein prep, anywhere from 5 to 20 nanomolar. 15 nanomolar was reported by ITC, so it is accurately showing, you know, the protein, or kind of, you know, measuring the affinity of the protein-protein interaction despite the fact that one of the proteins is immobilized. So that's important. And then to basically prove to ourselves that this is really working the way it was, we did a number of mutagenesis studies, so both mutations that are known to inhibit that interaction. So this is the native protein, and these are all modifications of EIF4E that are known to basically kill that interaction. And we see that we can vary the IC50. So this is a competitive assay depending on the mutant we use. So it looks like everything works well. So one thing that we want to do is high-throughput screening, but, you know, we do a lot of high-throughput screening in my lab, that we also chose to take a rational approach, okay? And to do this, we looked at what are known as stapled peptides, okay? So these are peptides that have a tendency to form a helix formation, just like our 4-ABP1 peptide, but, you know, they can be a little bit floppy as just a peptide. So what you do is you chemically constrain them at the I and I plus 4. So these are just like the termini of the little turns of the helix using a reaction known as cross-metathesis. Or I guess it would be, cross-metathesis is fine. So this is carried out by ruthenium catalyst, also a Nobel Prize winning reaction. And so there's a number of advantages of this that I won't talk about now. But we made a series of these stapled peptides, and we modeled them. And for time, I'll kind of go quickly. Of course, they work, so we have good IC50s, some low nanomolar. We have also done binding affinity. They're about 30 nanomolar binding affinity. They do show helicity, so they actually are constraining the natural sequence. Finally, they do some proliferation studies, so we can see that they basically can halt cellular growth in two different cell lines. Okay, so these things actually get into the cell and work. And this is another way to image this is for apoptosis, looking at nuclear staining. So if you increase the concentration, you increase the cell death in the cancer cell lines. They also act on target. So this is a pull-down activity of looking at the EIF4E and its binding to its two protein binding partners. So we have an assay for that, and we do see dose-dependent inhibition of that. So this is a project, so we'll skip ahead. Actually, I'll skip all this. That we're still kind of working on doing the SAR around this peptide to improve its more drug-like properties, since peptides aren't always good drugs. We need to improve affinity, and then with peptides you worry about proteolytic stability, since there are a lot of proteases in the cell that can chop up your peptide. My one student has started X-ray crystallography and then high throughput screening of our PPI CAD-ALCA to also find small molecule inhibitors of this. Okay. So we do a lot of stuff, all basically targeting translation, so a number of others. So in addition to this assay, we have other assays. We have fluorescent probes, some proteomics, structural studies, some protein NMR, other small molecule studies. So we're really trying to throw all of our chemical tools and methods to solve this one problem. Okay, so this is my current group. So we have 5 students, 2 techs, and a postdoc, so they're not all depicted here. This is an older picture. So my students come from 2 different programs, MedChem and ChemBio. We have a number of collaborators, both in proteomics, high-throughput screening, natural products, protein NMR. We'll thank these agencies for funding. And a thing to note is that University of Michigan has excellent graduate student funding, including a number of training grants. So those of you interested in proteomics, cancer biology, chemical biology, cell biotechnology, you name it, we have a training program for it. So we have a lot of tailored programs specific for your interests. And then just to kind of do the quintessential things. So MedChem is the program that I am in my home department. So we're a core group of about 13 faculty, but we also draw from many other departments, chemistry, biological chemistry, pathology, pharmacology, and radiology. Currently we have 42 graduate students across our labs. And the main kind of commonality of MedChem labs is that we are focused on applying chemical and molecular approaches for the purpose of drug discovery and development. And this research spans organic chemistry, biochemistry, which are my areas, also biophysics and chem informatics. And we do have an RU program for those of you who are interested in doing summer research. It's in the structure and function of proteins, but this is pretty broad to be med chem, chemical biology type studies. But if you're interested in doing summer research, I encourage you to check this out. And then on the flip side of med chem is our chemical biology program. This is a freestanding program, a much larger pool of faculty, much larger span of departments, a little bit bigger graduate student side. But this is more in the basic science, not drug discovery. So biological catalysis, biomolecular structure, function, and recognition, chemical genetics, and bioorganic chemistry. And not that you need to know this, but UM graduates go amazing places, and that's what we all want for you. So thank you for your attention, and I'd be happy to take any questions. It's really cool. It's a really good program. And they do a lot of other, you know, kind of get you ready for GREs and all the different preps throughout the summer. So it's a really nice experience. Yeah. Hi.
With each stage listed out, approximately how long does it take for you from the start until you get to the end of it?
I would say a few months. Yeah. There are some hiccups along the road in working with another division that our first, you know, I would say that's more accurate. We were learning to work with our Center for Chemical Genomics when we did the small molecule screen, and there'd be a lot of gap time, more on their end than our end. But it takes, you know, a good month to do the screening and then, you know, follow-up studies. Yeah. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Brendan Moots. I had a question about the assay, the FRET and the fluorescence activation. Mm-hmm. You know, you said there was, like, you get false positives and negatives almost every time. How do you, like, compensate for those and are, like, able to tell what's false or not?
That's a great question. So how you compensate for any assay, and this includes CatAlka, is, you know, even in luciferase assays, other types of assays, you get common interference. So what you always do is a secondary assay using some other type of readout. Okay, so if you do, you know, FP assay primary, you could do, you know, FRET secondary assay, and then you would weed out things from one or the other. Or you could do, and there's another assay called Alpha Screen, but we don't need to talk about that. You just do some other type of readout, and then that usually helps you to eliminate. There's also classes of molecules known as PAINs, or PAN assay interference compounds, and they're annotated by structure, known to be common false hits in high throughput screens. And in most of the databases, so for the CCG library, those compounds are starred. Actually, they have like a bright red asterisk, like, I'm a pain, don't try to keep following up on me. you may be really depressed afterward. A lot of money has been wasted following up on pains, which is why, actually, just even in Nature, I think a year or so ago, there was a big article on that in Nature about pains. Yeah. You'll get them.
I had a question. So there's a lot of research going on with somatic genetic manipulation, right? So what would be the advantage of controlling the translation compared to the actual genetic manipulation itself?
That's a good question. We don't know. We don't know if this is a good drug target. So we're really trying to, you know, identify molecules that could be probes to validate whether this would be a good way or not. So that's most of what we do are targets that are not validated as drug discovery targets, but we want to figure out ways to answer the question whether yes or no. And then if it's yes, we'll give it to someone else who has a lot more money and resources than we do to really go after it. Yeah. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Helen, and I was just wondering how these drug-targeting molecules would affect normal cells. So I guess what the side effects would be.
Mm-hmm. Great question. Your chair is the same question. Great minds think alike. We would hypothesize, so translation is definitely upregulated in highly proliferating cells. So if I had to guess right now, I think by targeting captopril translation, you would target hair and skin and other, like, highly proliferating cells. But they did do an antisense oligonucleotide against EIF4E in some advanced animal models and really don't see much toxicity. So whether that will translate to humans is unclear. But, yeah, that's something to definitely consider.
My name is Michael.
Hi.
What advice do you have for someone in using a chemistry degree to get into the bio field?
Do it. Get your Ph.D. in chemistry. This is exactly what I was told. Even as an undergraduate, I was like, you know, I really want to do the interface. And they didn't have chemical biology programs. I'm not even that old, and they didn't have them then. Now they're, you know, everywhere. And they're like, no, you need to have the fundamentals in chemistry, and then you can go and learn biology. And that's actually true, because most of biology is chemistry, and if you don't understand how things work, it makes it somewhat challenging. Even appreciating what molecules look like, right? You know, that is something, you know. So many biologists at U of M, and I probably shouldn't do this when it's going to be on camera, but I will. We tell them anyway. You know, they'll do a high throughput screen and they get all these molecules and they're like, well, now that's our drug, right? And it takes a long time to convince them, like, no, you have to do a lot of chemistry optimization. This isn't a drug. This is just a hit. And then, you know, you have to do a lot of steps down. Even just understanding those kind of simple things are very important. if I had to do it over again, I would never change doing, you know, even though there are some days where in the middle of grad school, I was like, you know, Kaz, that was my boss, I quit. I can't do this anymore. You know, I'm making molecules to be put on a shelf or the reaction doesn't work. You know, what's the point? What's the application? And he just would be like, Amanda, go back to the lab. You know, you're fine. Just go away. Like, I don't know what I'm going to tell you. And I really just was proactive about it and was like, fine. You don't want to help me do this. I'm just going to read. And I'm going to keep reading because, you know, they give me access to all the journals. And I'm going to, you know, read about what I want to do. And that's what I did. And then it was funny because at the end, you know, someone once had to do an enzymatic reaction just on an organic. They're like, Amanda, what does this mean, unit? And I'm like, see, you guys, read some more papers, you know. Be broad, you know. And that, yeah, you just have to, you know, do on your own. But now there are chemical biology programs and things where, you know, it's much more in fad. You can get enough of a chemistry background and biology. Although, yeah, you have to choose.
Hi, my name's Gabriel. I was just wondering if it's possible to use other RNA as your targeting molecule?
Yes.
Or is that just impractical because of the folding?
No, you could use any RNA, yeah. So even, so in terms of the dicer assay, you know, it's going to be a pre-microRNA because that's the substrate for the dicer. But why we want to get into RNA proteins is because most RNAs have protein binding partners, so in theory you could do any RNA. But you could also be clever and figure out, you know, new catalcas for manipulating new RNAs, right?
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Dylan Zimmerman. My question is probably a little bit basic, but what methodology do you use to find the click chemistry pairs in your reactions?
In terms of just characterization?
Yeah.
Like of how the reaction goes?
Yeah, like you look at two molecules, how would you determine these two would make a good click chemistry pair?
We didn't do that.
Oh.
I'm not that smart, no. we basically used, if I go back many slides, let's see. You should write this down, because, let's see, it's in the goofy mode. Presenter mode. Here you go. This is, you know, there's a nice catalog now. But I always tell my students, you know, there's limitations to all of these. Find me a new one. And someone we're trying to hire into my department now, I pose that question. He does a lot of high throughput chemistry, basically throw a bunch of stuff together and see if anything happens. And I was like, this is what you have to do for a new click reaction. So the low hanging fruits are things like cycloaddition chemistry, where they basically used to heat the crap out of it to get it to go. And then, you know, Barry Sharples came around and was like, let's just screen a bunch of, like, you know, inorganic salts and see if anything catalyzes it. And that's what they did. So go back to the old, old literature and read the papers that are probably in German or very old, you know, other languages, and find those reactions just like that. And then do some screening, you find a new click reaction. Yeah.
Read.
Yes, common theme. No. You're not going to find it on YouTube.
I know, but I'm being sarcastic.
Yes, I know.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Outstanding.
Yeah.
Outstanding.